This is real love. This is real love. Grand family, what's going on? It's Sunday. It's another day to be in the house of the Lord, in the presence of the Lord, wherever you're watching from, home, in your car, at your office, I don't know, wherever you're watching from. Welcome. So glad you're tuning in. Click down our link. You're here, ready to go. It's a special day because today is our Q&A. You submitted questions, and I'm going to do my best to answer those questions today. If you're live and in person with us, my wife and I are going to be doing it together. If you're here online, I'm going to be doing my best to bring the answers by myself. So prepare your heart, as is our custom. Our team is going to lead us into the presence of the Lord. So set your heart and your eyes on heaven and be ready. Get ready for a great day in church.
Up with an everlasting joy.
hope you are ready for our Q&A. We asked you last Sunday to submit your questions, things that you have questions about biblically that maybe you want some clarity on, want some answers on. So we're going to do our best. I'm going to do my best today to bring answers to your questions. Let me just give you a brief disclaimer up front here. Number one, I am not an expert on anything really that you asked. So I am going to do my best to bring my very best answer and do it from a biblical point of view. What does the Bible have to say about questions you submitted? Now, here's the disclaimer. You do not have to agree with everything that I present to you today. In fact, here's what if you do disagree with me, that is totally fine, totally awesome. Much of the questions we're going to be answering really deserve a much larger conversation, but we're going to do our best to fill it all in and give you an answer to your questions. But you don't have to agree. In fact, if you do disagree, I'd encourage you, go seek the answers for yourself. Start with the Word of God. What does the Bible actually say? And then find the answers for yourself. Listen, our goal in doing this today is really as believers to begin thinking critically and biblically about real life issues that you face, that I face, right? If the Bible truly is the light unto our path and the lamp unto our feet, then God knew long before you were ever created that your path and your feet would lead you to a conversation with an atheist. God knew that your path would lead you on a conversation with your neighbor about aliens. God knew that your path would lead you on a conversation about interpreting the Word of God. So our job and our goal today is to help you think biblically and critically about real life issues and conversations maybe you've had, maybe you're currently having, or maybe you will have. Again, not all of these questions you're going to think are, oh man, that's an interesting, maybe it's not for you, right? But just sit tight and we're going to be sure to get to all the questions we possibly can today. All right, you ready? Let me just give you one more disclaimer before we dive into the questions today. Everything I answer today outside of opinion-based questions, like, hey, give me your recommendation on so-and-so. So everything outside of opinion-based questions is going to come through the lens of Scripture. All right, now maybe you're here, you're watching today online, and you would say, I don't know that I believe everything in the Bible. Perhaps you believe that the Bible can be interpreted and mean several different things. Maybe for you, you don't even believe the Bible at all, right? So you're just kind of seeking and searching out answers for yourself. Totally fine. Just want you to know that every answer I give outside of opinion will be based upon and through the lens of Scripture. I believe personally, and here at our church, we believe the whole counsel of God's Word. We don't omit, we don't add to, we don't delete sections that aren't culturally relevant or that don't make popular sense today. We preach the whole counsel of God's Word. And so everything I say will be through that lens today. All right, are you ready? Are you ready to dive into these questions? I've got notes here to help me along the way, so don't mind me if I'm looking down, kind of checking my notes here today or scrolling down. I'm just trying to do my best here. All right, question number one. Do all religions lead to God? That's a great question. Maybe you asked that question. I want to do my best to answer it for you today. The short answer is no, they do not. I would say that all religions claim to lead to some source of higher power. Perhaps it is a deity that they claim, but not all religions lead to God. I'm assuming that the asker of this question meant God Almighty, Yahweh, Jehovah, the God that we serve. That's what I'm assuming you meant in your question. And I would say that not all religions lead to God Almighty, the God that we serve. And if they did, if all religions just led to God, well, what's the point of religion at all, right? The point of the religion you profess or the religion that you confess as your own is to be faithful to that higher power or that source of deity. In Christianity, we claim that God is we believe, and according to the Word of God, that God is the one true, the God we serve is the one true God. He is God Almighty. He is Alpha, Omega, beginning and the end. He is Yahweh. He is I Am, the God revealed in the Bible. This is the God that we serve. And this is why in Christianity, we have such a high prominence on sharing our faith and evangelizing our faith, because we believe that this is the only way. This is the one and the only way into relationship with God and into heaven for all eternity, which is why we place such a high prominence, high priority that you share your faith. So no, all religions do not lead to God. If they did, it would kind of dumb down every religion, right? It would be, well, why do you serve Buddha when it's going to lead to God? Why do you serve Islam when that's going to lead to God? Why are you a Christian when it's all going to lead to God? It kind of dumbs down every single religion. So the short answer is no. Again, we could go much deeper in religion talk, but the short answer is no, not all religions lead to God. Here we go. Question number two. Who created God? Have you ever asked that question before? Who created God? How did he come into existence? All right, I want to take us to the beginning of the Bible. Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1 says this. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning. All right, what are we talking about here? The beginning in Genesis is referring to the beginning of the timeline that you and I are currently living on today. In the beginning, right? That we believe in the seven-day creation story of the world, right? On day one, God created. On day two, created. Day three, created. On day seven, he rested. So we believe in a seven-day work or a seven-day week and a literal seven-day creation story account. So this is what we're talking about when we say in the beginning of all time, in this timeline that we're living. What existed prior to the beginning that we know, that this timeline that we're living on? Only God. God is the, according to the word of God, God is the uncreated, eternal God Almighty. The Bible uses phrases like Alpha and Omega, which just means this. It's the Greek words for the beginning and the end. Before time began, there was only God. God was uncreated. God has always been, and God will forever be. He is the eternal God. This is what eternality actually means. The eternal God means he has no beginning. He's always been, and he has no end. He will always be. Let me just suggest to you that this is part of the Christian faith, is faith in the existence that God always has been, and he always will be. And you say, Pastor, that doesn't quite make sense to me. And I understand that, because understanding the eternality of God is one of the mysteries that I don't believe our finite minds can fully understand. We understand it this way, that we are eternal beings, meaning this, that we have a beginning. The day you were conceived, your life began, right? You have a starting point to your life. But your life will have no end, right? Like in terms of biology, your heartbeat will stop beating, but you have a spirit and a soul inside of you. And that soul and that spirit will live on forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Well, God has no beginning. He is the uncreated, eternal God Almighty. He has no beginning. No one created God. God has always been. So when the Bible says in the beginning, at the beginning of our timeline, God is the one who created it all. He is the eternal, uncreated King of all kings and Lord of all lords, according to Scripture. And again, I know that there are many different variations and schools of thought out there, but this is the Christian perspective. This is the biblical God that we serve. All right, let's go on to question number three. This is a good one here. Number three, does the Grid Church believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit and in speaking in tongues? Maybe you've asked that question before. And if we have not made it abundantly clear, we are a spirit-filled evangelical church. We believe in the gifts of the Spirit. We believe in the working and the power of the Holy Spirit. So our answer as a church is unequivocally 100% yes. And I want to take us to Acts chapter 2. I'm not going to have it on the screen, but I want to just reference it for you. Acts chapter 2, there's an entire event that happens, right? Like Jesus has already ascended. He's died. He's been buried, resurrected. He's appeared to everybody. And now he's ascended into heaven. And he tells his disciples and the believers there in Jerusalem, don't leave Jerusalem until you receive the power of the Holy Spirit. Well, in Acts chapter 2, that actually happens. And in Acts chapter 2, verse number 4 says this, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled. So they all are speaking their native language. All of a sudden, the Holy Spirit comes upon them and they begin speaking in a different language, in a language unknown to their ears, unknown to everybody, as the Spirit enabled them. Now, we don't see in our church, as we have studied Scripture, we don't see that there be any reason to doubt or to mitigate or to even stop that working of the Holy Spirit. There's nowhere in Scripture that it says it was only for those people on that day that they spoke in tongues or spoke in a different language. We don't see anywhere in the Bible that it was only for them and no more, and then it stopped. And I believe, and I know that there are other denominations and fellowships, even within Christianity, that would say, no, it was only for those people in Acts chapter 2, but it doesn't go any further than that. We would disagree with that. I don't see anywhere from that point forward in the rest of the New Testament, there's nowhere that says that that work of the Holy Spirit was only for those people in that time. All right, so the working of the Spirit, there's two things that happen. When you give your life to Jesus, the Spirit comes in you, right? So now you have a conviction. Now you have a conscience. Now you know from the right and wrongs according to the Word of God. That's the Spirit working in you. But there's a second work, and this is the second work right here. The Spirit comes upon you. So He comes in you, and now He comes upon you. And He comes upon you, why? To give you power to be my witnesses across the globe. This is the working of the Holy Spirit. And we believe that the initial evidence of the Spirit coming upon you is the ability to speak in a different language that you may not know. The Bible calls it speaking in tongues, or we would say speaking in tongues, all right? So we 100% believe in it. We welcome it. We welcome it into our services. We welcome them into our prayer gatherings. And I'd encourage you, if you are seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit, don't stop seeking until you receive the working of the Holy Spirit in your life. All right, next question here. Give us your tips and your recommendations for getting into a Bible reading habit. Is it easier to follow a plan through the Bible in a year, or is there another way to approach it? And this is just solely my opinion. This isn't based upon Scripture. This is just solely my opinion. I just want to address the points there. Is it easier to follow a plan through the Bible? Perhaps for your personality, it may be. Go grab a one-year Bible or on your phone. If you have a phone, you can download the YouVersion Bible app, and it has thousands of plans you can follow, many of which are the Bible through, read the Bible through in a year. If that's your personality type where you need structure and you need to like check those boxes off, totally cool. Go get that. It gives you everything. You don't have to divvy it up yourself. It will do it all for you. There's actually audio versions of the year in a or the Bible in a year now. So you don't even have to read. You can just listen to it audibly. And that's an option for you as well. For me personally, I've done the Bible in a year where I've read through the Bible in a year. Personally, while I love the Word of God, I didn't like that approach. For me, I would much rather. So currently, I'm reading through 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. That's where I'm at in my own devotional time. And I would much rather take it very, very slow. So I may some days I may read a verse, right? And then like the Spirit starts talking to me, He starts prompting me, I'm communing with God in that moment. I may just read one single verse and God speak to my heart in that moment. There are other days I may read like a whole paragraph, a whole chapter. I may even read the whole book, right? And I'm just kind of working my way through that. I prefer to much rather pick a book, or if I'm going to read through the Bible, I'm going to read through the Bible, but I'm going to stop the moment that like there's some kind of nugget of truth that I believe God wants to speak to me. It's really dependent upon your personality type, but here's my challenge. You got to start. If you're not in the Word of God, this is the number one way God speaks to you still today. People are always like, what is God saying? What is God doing? How do I know what God wants to do in my, read the Word of God. God has not changed from the beginning of time. He has not changed since, from the very beginning of time, He has not changed. And He has written it down in His Word. And so if you want to know what God's saying to you, get in the Word of God. It is so critically important for you to develop that habit. Build it into your daily, there's nothing wrong with scheduling it in your daily routine. You wake up in the morning, I mean, I'm an early bird, I wake up about 4:45, and by 5 o'clock, I got my coffee in hand, and I'm spending time with Jesus, all right? So make it a daily, this is my non-negotiable time. Make it a daily calendar event if you have to. Get in the Word of God. All right, are you ready for a doozy of a question? The next question, would aliens disprove Christianity? Now, notice that the question, whoever sent this in, they did not ask, do aliens exist? They simply asked, would aliens disprove Christianity? So just keep that in your mind as we make our way through this question here. I don't know about you. I've always been intrigued by life in the universe outside of the Earth. I've just always been intrigued by that. Now, I'm not talking about bacteria, right? Or like there's life form that is growing on another planet. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in intelligent life forms in other planets and other universes and other, that's always been intriguing to me, all right? And as Christians, I would venture to say that we are open to the idea of life in other on other planets, life in other universes that we don't know, life outside of even the Hubble telescope reach. I believe that we are open to that idea. So my question, rather for whoever sent this in, my questions, I just have a million questions that I would love to ask back in return. Many of which, would we lose God's, if aliens do exist, right? If they do exist somewhere in the universe, the universes, the heavens, as we can call them, the skies, would we lose the existence of God? I don't think we would. Would it disprove the triune, the Trinity, like God Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit? I don't think it would disprove the Trinity. Would it disprove the death and resurrection of Jesus? No, I don't think it would. Would it undo forgiveness of grace through faith? No, I don't think that would be the case. Would God's future plan of resurrection be affected? No, I don't think that'd be the case either. Listen, the Bible, simply stated, does not say that aliens exist. And the Bible does not say that aliens do not exist. So we quite frankly, we just don't know. I mean, we always speculate, and the vast expanse of the skies, how could there not be other life forms out there? I don't know, quite frankly. So if aliens do exist, my simple question is, would it disprove Christianity? And I don't think it would, not by any means. Now, it does lead me to several different questions. Here's some of the questions that I'm working through personally, and I think maybe that'd be beneficial for you as well. If there are intelligent beings in other planets, in other universes, in the skies, the questions I have would simply be, do they have souls, right? If they are intelligent beings, do they have a spirit inside of them? And if they do, how would they obtain salvation? My next question would be, would Jesus' sacrifice on the earth, on our planet, be sufficient for life everywhere? All right, so for me, I have to go to the Word of God, right? So God created all things. God created the heavens and He created the earth. And when we say the heavens, when the Bible says the heavens, we're talking about the skies, the space, the expanse of the heavens and the space that we know and the space in the universes that we do not know. God created it all. And so if there is intelligent life form in other planets, I believe that God, Jesus' sacrifice would cover all creation. He is the God who created all things. We tend to kind of only think about the globe, or we tend to think about only us here on earth. But God created He created the earth. He created the heavens. He created the galaxy that we live in. He created the galaxies that we know of through the Hubble telescope and technology of space and astronomy. He also created the heavens that we do not know. So if there is intelligent life somewhere in the earth, I believe Jesus' sacrifice would be sufficient for all creation, even those that God created that we're not even aware of. In fact, if there is intelligent life, I just want to read this verse, Romans chapter 6, verse 9. Paul says this, "For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again." All right, death no longer has mastery over him. He died once for all, right? So Jesus, if there is intelligent life somewhere in the universe and the universes that we do not know of, I do not believe it would disprove Christianity. I believe that Jesus' death and his resurrection and his sacrifice would cover all of creation. So if there is intelligent life out there, and I'm not talking about bacteria, I'm not talking about growing or just some kind of water source, I'm talking about intelligent life. They have a brain, they have a will, they have a soul, they are eternal beings. I believe Jesus' death and resurrection would cover them as well. God created it all, so he would cover all of his creation. Are you intrigued that we're talking about aliens in church today? I do want to bring up one other point as it relates to aliens and life forms on other planets and universes and such. We often, when we hear stories of UFOs, or we've heard accounts of people talking about UFOs, you know, naturally what ends up happening is people have a couple different responses. Number one, they tend to think, oh, it's aliens. It's some kind of life force on another planet invading our Earth or invading our atmosphere. Or second option would be it's the government, right? Like Area 51 and things going on that the government's trying to keep secret and whatever. I would submit to you and suggest to you that there is another option as Christians. This is why we are open to the idea of intelligent life on other planets, because there is a spiritual war and a spiritual world that we are not always privy to in terms of our physical senses, meaning you can't always see what is happening in the natural. Sometimes it's happening in the supernatural. Maybe you feel it. Maybe you feel like an oppression or a depression. Maybe it is exhibited in the natural. Maybe you have seen some kind of unidentified foreign or flying object or whatever the case may be. I would submit to you that this may be very well a tool or something happening in the spiritual world that may be exhibited or recognized in our natural world. I believe that's very well may be the cause. Billy Graham said this: if our eyes were spiritually opened to the heavenlies, to the spiritual world, we would see a constant waging of war, good versus evil, bad versus good, right? Like demons versus angels. We'd see this constant waging of war. And I believe that at times, perhaps, we have been privy to the spiritual world being exhibited in our natural world. I think that is an option. Again, I don't have any, this is just me kind of giving you my thoughts. In terms of that. So the question, would aliens disprove Christianity? I don't believe that it would. That aliens, intelligent life on other planets or other universes that we know or don't know, I don't believe that that would disprove Christianity at all. I believe Jesus, God, the God of the heavens and the God of the earth, his sacrifice and his plan would cover his entire creation. Aliens and church. Never thought that would be something that we preach about, but here we are. I love it. Thanks for that question. Let's go on to the next one here. How do we determine the difference between text in the Bible that only relates to the cultural context of the time versus text that is transcultural, which means it's relevant for all time? So how do I tell when something is just for the Bible times? And how do I tell when it's for me today? Let me just start by saying this. When you're reading a work of literature, all right, and just for argument's sake, we're going to call the Word of God a piece of literature. It's a piece of literature that you're reading. When you're reading literature, it's very hard to apply hard and fast rules that are always going to apply to works of literature. It's just, you can't really do that, right? And so the mentality is, well, if the Bible says to do it, I'm just going to do it. Well, if that is your mentality, then I hope you haven't cut your hair, right? I hope you don't have any piercings in your body. I hope you don't have any tattoos, right? Like, if you're going to do everything the Bible says, let me just say it to you this way. Oftentimes, when reading the Word of God, like, especially when you're talking with people that may not be of the same faith that you're of, they will frequently grab a verse, just one verse in the Bible, and they're going to pick that one verse out, and they're going to be like, well, the Bible says this. What do you think about that? I totally disagree with that. Well, here's what I would say to you. You have to start with reading the verse in context, right? So read the entire thing in the length of the paragraph, in the length of the chapter, and in the length of the entire book that is written in. And then with the scope in mind of the entire Bible, you have to read it all in context. Oftentimes, the Bible is not telling you what to do. Oftentimes, it may be, you have to ask the question, is this a description, right? So like, if I'm reading the Word of God, is it just describing an event that actually happened, right? So like, and then Judas went out and hanged himself, right? And so like, that's a description of what happened. That's not telling you, do you need to go out and hang yourself, right? People will be like, oh, Judas hung himself, so I'm going to go hang. No, no, no. You have to read it in context. The other question to ask is it a prescription? Right? Is this telling me what to do? Again, there are no hard and fast rules, but you have to read it in context. Read the verse, read the passage in the entirety of its context. Let me just give you an example. Pastor, I know, he was reading through the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, right? The story and life of Jesus and his disciples and the miracles and the death and the resurrection, the whole thing, right? Those four books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. He had an idea one day. He's like, I'm just going to do whatever I read that day, whatever I read that the disciples did that day, I'm going to go do that thing that day, right? Sounds really like faith-filled. Sounds like, oh man, that's great right there, until you actually start reading the text and you recognize it doesn't work, right? So like Jesus goes to the disciples before they were disciples and he was like, hey, James, John, Peter, hey, why don't you drop everything you're doing? I know you have an entire fishing enterprise and you're a successful businessman. I want you to leave it all and I want you to come follow me. Well, does that mean that you're going to quit your job and you're just going to go do ministry for the rest of your life? Probably not, right? Like, or hey, James, John, I want you to go get some food, right? And they go grab some five loaves and two fish, they bring it back, and now they can feed 5,000 people. It doesn't work that way, right? Oftentimes the Bible is not telling you what to do, it's telling you or describing an event that actually happened in that time. Here, if you're looking for a hard and fast rule, I would say this, that the epistles, so like books like Paul wrote, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, Philemon, James, that we just got done with, those type of books, those epistle type books written to churches are often books telling you how you should live your life, telling you what you should do, what you should not do, or you know, things of those nature, all right? So you just have to read the entirety of the counsel of God, God's word, in context of the paragraph, the chapter, the book, and the entire Bible, all right? That's how you will really begin to know. I believe this with all of my heart, that the word of God has the power to be illuminated and come alive to anybody who opens it. If you take time and you open the word of God, he can speak to you the same way he can speak to me. I am no different than you are because I'm a pastor. I'm no different than you because I went to college to study the word of God. God can speak to me the same way he can speak to you and vice versa. All right, read the entire thing in context. And if you do have questions, ask me, ask my wife, ask a leader in the church. I would say you can Google it, but I would be very cautious and careful on resources. I can give you resources that you can look up and that are biblical and right and that I trust. All right, but read the entirety of the counsel of God in context. All right, let's go to the next one. This is a doozy. I hope you're ready for it. Question number, whatever number we are on. If a polygamist gets saved, should they get divorced? Just so we're all on the same page, polygamy is historically, traditionally, is one man with multiple wives, but nowadays it can be one person with multiple spouses, all right? So that's the idea here. It's one man or one woman with multiple wives or multiple husbands, all right? That's kind of the idea of polygamy there, and there are communities not only here in America, but worldwide that are polygamist communities. So let's say, for an example, a polygamist walks into our church one day and they get saved and they walk in. Let's just say it's one man and he's got five wives with him. All right. So they all walk in together. Hey, I'm whoever, I'm so-and-so, and here's my wife, so-and-so, here's my other wife, here's this wife, and here, all right. So you got five wives. They come in, he gets saved. Should he divorce all five of those women? I'm going to give you my thoughts. I have two different answers, all right? And I just want to walk you through my line of thinking on each of these answers here. It's really just let me give you my thoughts. Thought number one, in the New Testament, we don't have any commands. There is never a command in Scripture to divorce anyone. Now, we're going to talk about divorce here in a moment. Actually, there's a question about divorce, but there are stipulations under which you can get a divorce, but the Bible gives no commands whatsoever to actually divorce someone. So already we have, again, this is the line of thinking that I'm walking you through here. Already we would say this, that based upon that alone, I would suggest that polygamist remain faithful to the wives he is committed to, all right? So here's the second one, the second issue that I see. Divorce is a very serious issue. I would need to have serious cause for concern of the well-being of the women, of their mental state, of their physical well-being. I would need to have serious cause for concern for that man to divorce any one of the wives. While polygamy, listen, polygamy is never affirmed in the Bible, right? So if you, it's not affirmed, all right? I am telling you today, do not marry multiple people. It is not in the Word of God. And if you come to me asking me to perform a wedding like that, my answer is no, because it is not in Scripture. It is never affirmed in Scripture. While polygamy is never affirmed, it does appear as though the children of these oftentimes polygamous relationship, they have children. And it does appear to me from the Bible that these children are legitimate children, right? So I would have to look at the impact if they have kids. What's the impact of those kids? From that line of thinking alone, it appears to me as though that the wives, again, for our example's sake, in these communities, and they exist here in America, from these communities, the wives are dependent upon the husband for their source of livelihood, right? And their source of income and their source of taking care of the kids and taking care of the family. So based on that line of thinking right there, I would say I don't think that the Bible would recommend that man divorce the women. The third concern and issue that I would bring up when it comes to this is, what is the impact of the gospel in these communities? I think it's very interesting, possibly dangerous territory if you go into a polygamous community and say the only way you can be saved is if you divorce all your wives, right? Like all of a sudden we've placed an undue mandate upon people and we've given them now a stipulation that they must do to attain salvation. And that is not Scripture. Scripture is you are saved through faith, by grace, through faith alone. That's how you are saved. It's not because of anything you can do or cannot do. All right. Based on that line of thinking alone, again, I would say that polygamist must remain faithful to their wives, even if they get saved. So based on that line of thinking alone, the lean and the inclination of that thinking, and I'm not saying that this is my thinking, I'm just giving you this line of thinking. Based on that thinking alone, the lean and the inclination would be that man should remain faithful and committed to the marriages that he devoted to before God and before the wives, right? That would be the lean and the inclination. Here's the one massive caveat, though, so if they came to our church, here's the massive caveat that I would have, and that I would sit down and I would talk with them with. I would say that, listen, you know, if you are saved and you're serving the Lord, that is awesome, but you were then disqualified for any leadership whatsoever in the church. You're not going to lead anything in our church, because it, again, your relationship, while that line of thinking is, I can see the logic in that line of thinking, it's not scriptural. It is not biblical. It is not a biblical marriage. And that would then disqualify them for any leadership whatsoever in the church. Now, let me give you the other line of thinking. And this is really my line of thinking. This is kind of where I would fall into. This is kind of where I would lean. This is my inclination right here. It appears to me adultery is a sin constantly. In the Bible, it's always recognized as sin. There's never a moment where adultery is not sin. And in a polygamous relationship, adultery is happening constantly, whether you have two wives or whether you have multiple, more than two wives. It's constantly happening. You're constantly, that man is constantly being committed to one wife while he's with her intimately. He's being unfaithful to another wife, right? And to another wife and to another wife. So you're constantly, there's constantly adultery going on in that relationship. So while the other line of thinking would say that man should, according to the Bible, again, it's very tricky territory. According to that line of thinking, I think that polygamist should remain faithful to the wives. However, the wives at that moment have every opportunity to divorce their husband, right? Because he is being unfaithful. While his role and his commitment is to remain faithful to his wives, the wives have no obligation in that regard. And according to Scripture, adultery is a legitimate concern for you to seek a divorce from your spouse. And so I would simply say that if that is a case, or if that's a concern of yours, or you're in a relationship like that and there's constant adultery going on, you have every right to divorce your spouse. All right, that's going to lead us right into our question about divorce. The question is, what are the stipulations under which I can get a divorce? That was the question that came in, and I want you to notice how personal that question is. What are the stipulations under which I can get a divorce? And I just want to say this before I give you the answer to that. If you are contemplating divorce and you're in a relationship where you're unhappy, or things are wrong or evil, or there's sin or something, and you're contemplating divorce, Can I just pastorally encourage you? Reach out, talk to us, talk to me, talk to my wife, talk to our leadership team, talk to someone in the church. Just let them know. I mean, we God believes in the union of marriage and the vows that you committed to at the altar. There are stipulations under which God gives you provision as a way out, right? And we'll give you those here in a second. But if you're seeking divorce and there's something going on that that no one's aware of, talk to someone, get some help, seek professional help, seek help from the church. We're here. We pray for you. We believe in the union of marriage. But if you're looking for a way out, or you need a way out, you just need someone to talk to, let us know. All right. Let me just give you our disclaimer up front here. I believe in the union of marriage. I believe God's design in the union of marriage. I believe in it wholeheartedly. A man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. That is a serious bond and a serious commitment that you make in your vows before God and before your spouse and before your family and friends and whoever attends your wedding, right? That is a serious union and a serious bond. And in fact, many times in a marriage, that marriage is a biblical picture of God's love for you, right? Like what God would do anything. He did anything for you by sending his son to die for you. And in a marriage relationship, often that is the case as well. You would do anything for your spouse. So we believe in the union and the union of marriage. That being said, God does give provisions in the Bible that it is acceptable and totally fine for you to get a divorce and to seek remarriage, because that ultimately is not always the goal, but certainly is a goal sometimes when you're seeking a divorce. I just want to get out of this relationship so I can go seek another relationship that's going to bring me happiness and fulfillment. Again, that's not everybody. I know that I'm kind of lumping a bunch of people into one category. That's not always the case, but that often is the case that I see, at least in the church. So here are the stipulations from the Word of God in which you were able to get a divorce. Number one is death, right? So your spouse dies, you are no longer bound legally or biblically to the vows that you committed to that person. They have biologically died, and you are free at that point from the vows that you made before God and before everybody in that wedding ceremony. You are free from the vows and the bonds of your marriage to go and to live singly or live in a relationship or to seek remarriage. You're totally good to do that. The second second stipulation that God gives in the Word of God is adultery or infidelity. All right. So if you're in a relationship currently and your spouse has stepped out on you and had an affair on you, and here's how we define affair. Obviously, there is a physical affair where they have had intimate relationship with someone other than you. That would certainly count. We would also count an emotional affair where somebody is more committed to, maybe they met or they're DMing somebody online or reconnecting with an old flame or an old girlfriend, boyfriend, whatever the case may be, and they've developed this emotional relationship, maybe DMing, texting, maybe they meet in person but haven't had physical relations at that point, but they are more committed to their emotional relationship with this other person. That would count as an affair as well. And then I would also add in there that sexual sin would also fall under that category as well, where if you confront your spouse who may be addicted to pornography, maybe just so engulfed in that life where that's all that they are about, right? That's all they can think about. They no longer view you in a sexually intimate way, but they're viewing more images and videos, and they're more committed to that life, to the life of lust and to the life of videos and pictures and images and pornographic films and whatever. If they're more committed to that than they are to you, then they have abandoned their vows that they made to you to love and to protect you and to be faithful to you only. So that's kind of how we would define adultery and infidelity. So that is another stipulation that God gives in the Word of God. And you can find all of this, Mark chapter 10. Jesus gives a whole discourse on divorce and remarriage. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. You can find the entire teaching of Paul on the topic of divorce and remarriage as well. And these are all going to be laid out in there as well. And then the third stipulation, and this is one often not talked about, but still very much God gives provisions for it in the Word of God, is abuse or abandonment, right? So if you find yourself in a relationship that is abusive, right? Where there's physical harm being done to you. This is very personal to me. This is the relationship that I grew up in. My parents was a very abusive relationship. My dad was physically abusive in our home and in our family. And it got to a point where there was concern for our safety, where, I mean, it led to a point where my dad tried to kill my mom. So there was legitimate concern for safety. And all the while, my mom was seeking counsel from the church, and the church's counsel was, oh, you need to seek restoration and forgiveness and all of that. And I'm all for restoration, all for forgiveness, 100%. But this was a legitimate concern for the safety, where he ended up trying to kill her, right? So like all of a sudden, things have all of a sudden shifted now. So if you're in a relationship where you are being abused, your spouse has abandoned their vows to love and to protect you, right? They have abused you and they have abandoned you in that regard. They've abandoned you mentally, they've abandoned you physically at that point. You are free from the vows of your marriage bond at that point. And you are free to seek help. You're free to get out of that relationship. And again, if that is you, it's describing you, come talk to us. We want to help. We want to walk the journey with you today. All right, let's keep on going here. We got a few more questions here. We've got a ton of questions, but we just don't have time to get through them all. And in fact, all of these questions really deserve an entire conversation and really dialogue back and forth. So question came in here, says this: I come from a traditional Catholic family, very common in Chicago. I respect and love my family who are still of the Catholic faith, but I disagree with the Catholic faith. And then the question is, are Catholics saved? And there's a second part to the question: Will Catholics go to heaven? Talk about a very easy question here to deal with here. It's gonna be fun. Let's dive into this one here. First and foremost, I gotta make this clear. I don't know any man's heart. All right, I don't. And while I can look at your life and see the fruit of your life according to the word of God, and I can say there's fruit in your life, or perhaps there is no fruit in your life, I still don't know your heart, and I cannot be, and I will never be the judge to say you're going to heaven or you're not going to heaven. I cannot know any man's heart. So while you may profess whatever it is, you may profess Islam, you may profess Catholicism, you may profess Christianity, I still don't know your heart. And if you, in your heart, there's been a salvific work of the Holy Spirit in your life where Jesus has transformed your very life, then you are going to heaven, all right? So that being said, I don't know where any person's heart is. I know where my heart is. God knows where my heart is, but I cannot know any person's heart. Let me just answer the question, or maybe start the answer by saying this. John chapter 14, and again, everything I say comes through the lens of Scripture. All right, so I'm not reading a different book. Everything I'm bringing to you is through the lens of Scripture. John chapter 14, Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one, not you, not your mother, not that person, not the other person, no one comes to the Father except through me. No one comes to the Father except through me. Much of the, and here's where it gets a very, very tricky and very interesting. Much of the Catholic faith flies in the face of that truth alone, right? So I would say this: Catholicism is very much of a works-based faith, right? Like, what can you do? How many Hail Marys? How many times can you go to confession to really make amends for the sins you've committed and the things that you've done to make your penance and your eternity less miserable, right? Like, how can I work my way out of hell and into heaven? That's kind of the way it works. Well, Christianity is totally different. It's not about work. There's nothing you quite literally can do at all. You are saved by grace through faith alone, right? So that means that all it requires is belief. You believe that Jesus lived and he died and he rose again, and you ask him to in your heart, and you forgive, he gives you of all yours. There's nothing you can do, and there's nothing you will ever have to do to attain salvation. It only requires a belief. And Catholicism requires a works-based type relationship. So all that said, I believe that there are genuinely born again Catholic people who just don't know that they are born again believers and Christians because of their family tradition, how they were raised, the church they grew up in. the fact that they went to, you know, confession, the fact that they went through catechism, the fact that they were baptized in the Catholic Church. Perhaps there's a person, there's a Catholic people out there who are genuinely say they have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and they just claim Catholicism because of the tradition that they grew up in. Perhaps they are saved. I believe that the converse of this is true as well. I believe there are genuine, devout Catholics out there who genuinely believe that they are going to heaven. They have a relationship with Jesus, but because of their good works and all the different things and all the different rules and regulations there, they have no relationship with Jesus whatsoever, and they've made it a works-based relationship. So Paul says this in the book of Galatians. He says, if anyone comes to you and preaches a gospel other than the true gospel, what's the true gospel? Jesus came, lived a perfect life, died for your sin. He did it all for you. All you need to do is believe. If anyone preaches to you anything different than that, then you have turned to a different gospel. Again, I can't speak to the heart. I can just simply speak to what they preach, and what they preach is contrary to the word of God. And I would hope that any Catholic hearing the word of God has a genuine transformational work in their heart. I would hope that to be the case. I don't write scripture, I just preach the word of God. And if there are any Catholics watching today online and you have turned to a different gospel other than the fact that Jesus did it all for you, this is the true gospel. He did it all for you. He loves you, and he has a plan for your life. And all you need to do, if I can even say that, all that is required is that you have faith and you believe that he actually did it all for you. Listen, I'm not trying to come against the Catholic Church. I'm not calling the Catholic Church a cult. I'm not saying that Catholics are evil. None of that is the case whatsoever. I simply believe that no one comes to the Father except through Jesus Christ. And if there are any works placed in the way, if there's any person placed in the way, if there's any mediator put in the way, it's a false gospel. It's a different gospel. And again, I'll just end by saying this. Only God knows the heart. Only God knows your heart. Only God knows your family's heart. So I can't answer, are they saved or are they going to heaven? Only God knows that. I would say that if they believe the word of God and they have a relationship with Jesus, then absolutely they are saved and they're going to heaven. If they believe any other gospel and they put their hope in anything other than Jesus himself, then they are not saved and they're not going to heaven. All right, let me give you our final question. And really, I have more here. I just can't get through all of them. We're quickly running out of time here. Let me say, I should have said this at the very beginning, but let me say this. Our notes are all available. We've made them available on our website, thegrid.church/Q&A. You can go there and download our entire notes. We've got tons of scripture, tons of arguments, tons of lines of thinking in our, there's probably 25, 30 pages of notes you can actually download here. And I would say, go download them, go read them for yourself. You can hear our thoughts. You can hear the lines of thinking. You can hear the arguments. You can hear the questions that we asked while you were asking questions. You can see all of that there. And again, there's tons of scripture to support every answer we're giving. The final one, really, honestly, I hesitate even bringing this one up because it requires, honestly, we could preach about the Holy Spirit for the rest of eternity and never really fully understand the infinites of God because we are so finite right now. So here's the question. The Trinity. Can you defend the Trinity biblically? Can you explain the doctrine of the Trinity? I've always been confused by this concept. And this, you're not alone. I mean, the idea of the Trinity. So there is one God represented in three persons. Maybe you've heard that before. So there's God the Father, there's God the Son, and then there's God the Holy Spirit. Each one of the individual persons are God, but each one of the individual persons are not the other person, right? So God is not the Son. The Son is not the Spirit. The Spirit is not God, is not the Father, right? So it's this whole idea. It's a very interesting idea. And so critics of the Trinity say this, the triune God, one God in three persons, that doesn't make sense because the word Trinity is never found anywhere in the Bible. And to them, I would say you are 100% correct. The word Trinity is never found in the Bible whatsoever. And my simple argument back to them, if they are a believer, is listen, do you believe that God is all powerful? Do you believe that is the case? And more times than not, they say, yeah, I believe that God is all powerful. We have a word for that. It's called omnipotent. He is omnipotent. Omnipotence is the theological term that we have given the concept of God's all-powerfulness. I would say this, do you believe that God is all-wise and he is all-knowing? And more times, if they're a believer, they're going to say, I do believe that as well. We have given the term omniscience, right? So although what the Trinity is, what we defined the Trinity, it's simply a theological term that we have placed upon the concept of God being one God in three persons. Again, I have tons of scripture here to support the fact that there is one God represented in three distinct individual persons. I don't have time to go through it all. In fact, this would be a great, if I have a free Sunday coming up, right? I should preach through the doctrine of the Trinity. Can I defend it biblically? Yes, I can. And I have it all laid out in my notes. Go download the notes and you can have them all for yourself. But I probably need to preach through this on a separate Sunday. The idea is this, the concept is this, that the God we serve is one God represented in three persons. We see God the Father all the way from the beginning. We see God the Son all the way from the beginning. And we see God the Holy Spirit all the way from the beginning. And we see all three represented all throughout the entirety, the whole counsel of Scripture. So that's the idea. That's the concept. We place the term Trinity, which is never found in the Bible, 100% correct. That term, you will never find that term anywhere in the Bible. But we have given it a doctrinal name to identify the concept that is 100% prevalent in Scripture. All right, that is our Q&A. Again, I've got a ton of other questions here. We're probably going to do this again because, again, we have more questions come in than we could ever even attempt to answer. And I didn't even answer some of the ones I really wanted to answer. So we're probably going to do this again. I hope this has been beneficial for you. Again, our goal is this, that you begin thinking biblically and you begin thinking critically through issues that maybe you're aware of, issues that maybe you have conversations with, issues you may not even be anywhere closely aware of. Like one of the questions we had was, why is Esther in the Bible? Great question. Maybe you've never thought about that. Begin thinking critically and biblically. Maybe you have questions about things like alcohol or things like abortion. What does the Bible say about these type of things? Begin thinking critically and biblically through these type things. All right, let me pray for us together today. God, I thank you for your word. I thank you that it is alive and living and active. I thank you that it comes alive to every person who opens it and spends time reading your word. And I pray that today it would come alive in our lives. I pray that as we have sought answers to these questions, maybe there is agreement, maybe there is disagreement. I pray as we have conversations coming up in the next days and weeks and months, God, that you'd begin leading our conversation and bringing us into an awareness of who you are in our lives. God, may we not have a heart of contention or a heart of debating, but Father, may we have a heart that wants to know you more and make you famous and make you known. You know, maybe today you're watching online and you say, Pastor, for me, the reality is I really appreciate this Q&A, but it sparked so many questions in my life that I already have. Maybe for you, there was a time in your life and you would say that you were a believer, you were a Christian, and life has just gotten such that where you're not living for the Lord anymore. Maybe for you, there's never been a moment when you've made Jesus the Lord and the Savior of your life. I want to give you an opportunity in light of all the questions we went through today. I want to give you an opportunity to accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. So I'm going to pray a prayer and I'd invite you to pray with me. Say, Jesus, I love you. And Jesus, I need you in my heart. I need you in my life. And I need your grace. Jesus, come into my heart and forgive me and free me and fill me with your spirit, I pray. I am chosen. I am a child of God now and forever. Amen and amen. Hey, church, that is awesome. If you prayed that prayer for the very first time, or you've prayed that prayer multiple times, I just want to say welcome to the family of God, or welcome back to the family of God. We've got some info down below at the bottom of your screen. Text in that number. Click that link. Let us know. Greatest decision of your life. We want to walk the journey with you, put some resources, connect you with people who have done this, who have walked this journey, the same journey you're walking, connect you with them and just get you plugged into a local church. Even if it's not our church, we want to get you plugged in to a local church. Once again, if you're checking us out for the first time, so glad you're here on a very unique Sunday. What we do here at our church, we pick a book of the Bible and we preach our way through it. We are between books right now. We just concluded James, and we are going to be starting 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John next Sunday. Sunday. So we preach through the Word of God verse by verse. So you're here for the first time, maybe on a very unique Sunday. Hope you found some value. Hope you found some intelligent nuggets of truth today that you can take away. I hope you found inspiration to get into the Word of God and begin thinking biblically and critically. Got some info down below. If you are a first-time guest, text in, click that link, let us know. Want to hear your story? Share a little bit about our story as well. Come hit the streets with us every single Sunday night and every other Monday night. We're on the street bringing life to our city, one neighborhood at a time. We're bringing life to the homeless population here in Chicago. We hit the uptown underpasses at Wilson and at Lawrence, and then we go to Lower Wacker. And we have seen God do phenomenal things. I'm telling you, God will bless you. He will bless your family for the time that you give back to serving a population often forgot about. Info down below. Get involved. Get plugged in. If you're giving, thank you, church. Honestly, it's making a massive difference that we're able to do what we do here every single week in reaching our city one neighborhood at a time. All the info is down below for you to keep on being faithful in your tithing and in your offering and in your missions giving. Your dollars are going across the world, not just here, they're going across the world. So thank you, Grid family. Hope you have a phenomenal week. Hope you found some wisdom and some truth today from the Word of God. I hope you're inspired to dig into the Word of God and to begin finding these answers for yourself. Church, we love you and we pray for you every single day. Have a phenomenal week and an incredible day in the presence of the Lord. We'll see you right back here on the link, or you're invited live and in person at the Donk House next Sunday morning at 11 a.m.